Okay, so today for this presentation, I wanted to focus on ways that we can reduce the CO2 we put into the air by driving our cars. So there are really two main goals that I want to accomplish through this presentation. One is I want to sort of explain some of the alternative energies that are being used to power some cars on the market today. And I also want to really emphasize the importance of hybrid cars and using that in our society. So, I want to begin with this blurb here from the Department of Transportation, Department of Energy, rather. It talks about something called CAFE, which, as you see, stands for Corporate Average Fuel Economy. And basically, in a nutshell, the CAFE standards are ways that the government can set a minimum for fuel economy levels in order to decrease our dependence on foreign oil, save people money at the pump, and just also reduce our energy consumption. So, some possible solutions to reducing our CO2 emissions, these are really simple ones. One is just to drive less. If we use our cars less, if we're using public transportation, carpooling, walking, biking, etc., then we don't have to use our cars, we don't have to put CO2 in the atmosphere. Another way, and I'll go into these last two a little later, would be buying a car that runs maybe on electricity or a hydrogen fuel cell vehicle or another alternative energy vehicle, or just to buy a hybrid car. And later, I'm really going to emphasize the last point because I think that's probably the most practical solution we can use right now. To be perfectly honest, our cars are such an integral part of daily life, considering how far we live away from like school, how far our parents commute to work, that it's probably not feasible to take public transportation or bike or walk or something like that. And there are some cons to buying an alternative energy vehicle, so I really think the best way for us right now would be to switch to a hybrid car. So briefly, I'm just going to talk about two types of alternative energy vehicles on the market today. The first I want to cover is electric cars. What I have here in the top corner here is a Tesla Model S, and in the bottom is a Nissan Leaf, both electric cars that are on the market today. The great thing about electric vehicles is that they have no tailpipe emissions. You have no internal combustion engine, you're not burning fuel, so there's really nothing to emit into the atmosphere. But of course, as I said here, the cons are they're generally pretty expensive. There's also the idea of being anxious about having enough range to make it to your destination and back, and then the long time it takes to charge. When it comes to price, the car up top is a luxury car, costs $100,000. Unless you have that kind of money to drop on the car, then it's probably out of the reach of the common man. The Leaf here starts at $28,000. But with federal tax credits, it comes down to about 21. So it's a lot more affordable, but you still have the problems of range. For example, they say that on an overnight charge, so about 8 hours or so, you've got 84 miles of range, and that should be enough to get you to where you need to go. But of course, that power consumption depends on how fast you drive, and you know what accessories you're using, like the radio, the heat, air conditioning, all that kind of stuff. So hopefully, as electric cars continue to develop and the range gets comparable to that of gasoline cars, they'll become more popular. Another type of alternative energy vehicle is the hydrogen fuel cell car. The cool thing is when you're using the way they work is to use hydrogen and convert it into electricity basically, and and everyone's almost as an electric car, with the only emission being water vapor. So, in that case, you're not emitting any greenhouse gases, which is good. The only problem is there's a low availability of these cars, just because this is a very new and still kind of experimental technology. Auto manufacturers have to figure out a way to store the hydrogen on board, how to create the infrastructure for people to refuel, and also to make sure that you have enough range to drive to your destinations. This particular car made by Honda is called the FCX Clarity, and when I went on Honda's website, you can only lease this car. They don't sell it, but hopefully, as this technology is further developed, more cars like this will be on the market. So that brings me to the last solution, the one that I think is probably the most feasible, and that is just buying a hybrid car. And all a hybrid is you have a car that runs with a conventional gasoline engine, and then you supplement that with an electric motor. So I guess the plus would be you have quicker acceleration, you have the electric motor, which is giving you 100% power from 0 miles per hour. You have that extra assist for, let's say, highway merging, you get a little extra power there. But at the same time, if you're just cruising around town, you can run this car on just all electric mode and not have to burn any gas at all. The batteries are storing the energy. And whereas in a traditional car, when you step on the brakes and all that kinetic energy is just dissipated as heat, in these cars, it's recharging the batteries to give you further range. So there are really some of the benefits of owning a hybrid would be the increased fuel economy, as I mentioned before, the increased power, but also because you have that electric engine working in tandem with the gas motor, you know, you don't need an alternator, you don't need a starter motor, that's taken care of by the electric motor. And the fact that you have fewer moving parts, that compensates for the higher upfront cost of purchasing the car with lower maintenance costs. So I want to show you guys a quick video here. Let me see, pull it up there. And this is from the Department of Energy. It's talking about the differences and the advantages of having a plug-in hybrid versus like a regular hybrid. So hopefully this works. Okay. Plan B. So I'm just gonna talk to you about it. No, man, it's internet. It's an internet problem, I think. Okay. Hotspot shield. Do you imagine? If not, I've got a backup for it. Well, I guess in the meantime, I guess at a different time. All I really wanted to say about the difference between a plug-in hybrid versus a traditional hybrid is that plug-ins, they're a little bit more expensive than a regular hybrid just because you have to, for example, you have to pay for charging stations. It's a good idea to put like a 240-volt charging station in your home, in your garage, so you can charge it overnight a lot quicker. They cost a little bit more upfront than a traditional hybrid, but ultimately, you're going to make that money back by fuel savings, lower maintenance costs, etc. So I'm just going to close by showing you all some of the hybrids that are on the market today. You all already probably know about the Toyota Prius. It's been on the market for a good 10, I think even longer than that, 10 years. And then next to it is a hybrid made by Honda called the Insight, which I think has also been on the market for a while. But I don't know about you all, for me, one thing that turns me off about a hybrid is just the look of these things. I don't particularly like them, being honest. But auto manufacturers have been working to make variants, hybrid variants of many mass market family sedans. Like, here you've got a Ford Fusion on the bottom, a hybrid hybrid Honda Accord, and a hybrid Toyota Camry, cars that maybe some of you all drive or maybe your parents have. They only cost roughly 2 to 4,000 more than, let's say, the regular gasoline variant, but you make that money back over the long term. So, thank you. That's really all I have.